Welcome, everybody. We're going to be starting the webinar now, and we've kindly gotten the public power entities to pull together a primer on Public Power 101. What we've decided to do today, because so many people registered, is to do this in a format that would allow folks to basically type in a question, and the panelists will answer questions as appropriate as we go through the deck. We're going to start off just giving sort of a primer of Public Power 101. Jolene Thompson from AMP Partners is going to be presenting initially, and then we'll have a number of other of the Utility Advisory Committee public power entities also present some background on their individual utilities. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Jolene, and as we're going through, do please feel free to type questions into the chat box that you each will see on the webinar, and I'll make sure to pass those on when we get to the end. So, Jolene, you want to start off, please?
Sure. Thank you very much, Lisa, and thank you to everyone for calling in today. We really appreciate it. As Lisa indicated, my name is Jolene Thompson. I'm an executive vice president with a public power joint action organization called American Municipal Power. We're based in Columbus, Ohio, operate in 9 states, and you'll hear a little bit more about each of the public power participants here at the end of this call. We are relatively new to the Utility Advisory Committee. We thought that the advanced energy economy was a great forum for exchange of information within the utility sector, as well as with different vendors that are working with our member communities, our member municipal electric systems. And so when we joined, one of the things that we had a conversation with the folks at AEE and the other public power entities about is the fact that we thought it made some sense to do a primer on public power. Perhaps not all of the vendors and the different organizations and companies that are members of AEE are familiar with public power. I know there are a lot who are, but there may be some who aren't. And we're very different. If you look across the country, we have some things that we share in common, but we also do some things a little bit differently. So we pulled together a primer, as Lisa indicated for you, and we'll go through this and talk about some of the basic facts about public power systems and what makes us different and how to best do business with us and some of the things that we bring to the table. Lisa, do I need to tell you to advance this, or can I somehow advance this, the slides?
Yeah, Eric will do that. Eric, can you please go forward on the slides?
So our overview today, we'll talk a bit about how public power systems compare to the other types of electric utilities, about a little bit about who we are, facts, figures, governance, and then each of the public power UAC members who are able to participate today have some individual slides to go through to talk about their operations. Eric, can you advance the next slide, please? So this is our comparison, the types of things that we'll be talking about. And joining me in presenting the basic information will be John D'Estacio, who heads up the Large Public Power Council. John will be on here in just a few slides. Eric, you can go forward. So the three types of electric utilities, and I assume most folks on the call are familiar with this, and I assume we may have some folks from some of these other types of utilities on the call as well. So public power systems, which include municipal electric systems, so cities and villages that own their own electric systems, you have boroughs, you have public utility districts, you have a variety of different types of utilities that own their own electric systems that fall under the banner of public power utilities across the country. You also have rural electric cooperatives and investor-owned utilities. Obviously, the focus of this discussion today is on public power and what we do and how we do it. So our business model is not-for-profit. We are community-owned. I think it works to say that our shareholders and our customers are one and the same, effectively. We do have some FERC jurisdiction, but it's only for interstate transmission. Very limited instances of regulation by state public utility commissions. There are some light-handed regulation in some states, but for the most part, there's a recognition that because we are community-owned, the decisions about our rates and our policies, procedures, and our operations are made at the local level by city councils, boards of public affairs, all in a very open process with input from the community and, in many cases, boards that include additional boards, advisory boards, at least in my case, in my member communities where they have citizens that are involved and active as well. Our primary form of financing is tax-exempt bonds. And you can see here on this slide the differences between the three types of utilities. Eric, you can advance the slide. So number of electric utilities in the United States. Obviously, if you think about it, there's individual cities and towns, so the numbers of public power systems are larger than of the other types of utilities, as you can see here. So you're going to have the rural electric cooperatives are going to have a lot more geographic territory. The public power systems are going to have a lot more customers. And you can go to the next slide, Eric. Eric, you can advance. Okay. So again, this gives you an idea of the number of customers served. And again, if you're looking at the actual customers, you're looking at, and I think I maybe said this wrong on the last slide, we have more systems, more actual individual utilities. The investor-owned utilities have more customers. So this makes sense based on size and scope of the country covered. You can go to the next slide, Eric. Retail price comparison. Now, this obviously varies across the country, and it depends on the generation portfolio mix of the utilities in that region. But on average, the average home electricity prices in the United States, you can see that we compare favorably with privately owned or an investor-owned utility. Obviously, there is, because our customers and shareholders are one and the same, there's a real desire and motivation to keep costs as low as possible. And so that's what we see in the majority of public power systems across the country. Obviously, again, this varies depending on the generation portfolio in the region. Eric, you can go to the next slide. So generation by amount of generation. So how much of the generating capacity in the United States is owned by the different types of utilities? Obviously, independent generators own a big chunk of that, the investor utilities as well. The federal power agencies, which in many cases provide power, well, in all cases provide power to co-ops and public power systems, are also a slice of that. But you can see public power systems, albeit have a lot of systems, don't have the bulk of the generation. We have about 10% of the generation in the country. And you can go to the next slide, Eric. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm John, I just took some of your slides, so I will turn this over to you.
That's okay. Yeah, thank you, Jolene, and I apologize in advance for my voice quality. I'm recovering from a virus here, but I'm John DeStasio. I'm the president of the Large Public Power Council, so I represent the 26 largest public power systems in the United States, 12 states and about 30 million consumers, and we're all part of the public power community, but the larger systems tend to have a lot of the generation and transmission assets. Formerly, I was the CEO at SMUD, the Sacramento Municipal Utility District. So I would just tap on a couple things that Jolene said. Relative to retail price comparison, our tax-exempt status does provide us some benefits, but that's changed significantly, especially with the recently enacted tax reform. The investor-owned utilities benefited significantly in the form of lower rates. So a lot of the differential in our price is really the fact that we don't have shareholders, so our dividend really is returned back to consumers in the form of lower prices. When you look at generation comparison, I think one of the things that's unique, the slide that's in front of you, is that our resource mix is somewhat comparable, with the exception of the hydroelectric, where there's about 20% in public power systems compared to 4 in the investor-owned utilities. And a lot of that really comes from the development of the vast hydro resources in Pacific Northwest. There's a significant number of public power systems there, as well as other parts of the country. But collectively, we sit at about somewhere around 40% carbon-free versus about 27% for the investor-owned utilities. And, of course, that varies significantly by state. I think some of the states you would – the state I was familiar with is California, where I was a CEO. We didn't have coal. So this is really averaged across a significant number of systems. And most people are continuing to move away from coal. Natural gas is a regulating fuel. And so I do think renewables will be growing, and you're going to continue to see this mix change. I will say just a few short years ago, coal was north of 50%, and now it's something under 40%, I think. So you can go to the next slide. So besides the dividend we pay in the form of lower rates or lower prices, Public Power's other big dividend really is reliability, that along with environmental stewardship. So you can see the average outage time for electric customers. Now, to be fair, private utilities and electric cooperatives in many cases serve significant rural areas, but this is averaged across on a customer per customer basis. So it's pretty representative, and I think one of the things that most public power systems pride themselves on is having excellent reliability and excellent responsiveness when there's issues related to weather or other things that impact the provision of electricity. You can go to the next slide. So one of the things when you look at what is public power, and I was mentioned a little bit earlier, besides the things on the slide, yes, we're not for profit. Yes, we're owned by the community. I would say all of those things are accurate. They also create a direct accountability to consumers and the communities that they serve through local governance, so that there is a very strong connection to achieving the objectives that are laid out by the municipalities or the communities that are served by public power systems. Many times we're instrumental as part of the economic development initiatives, the environmental initiatives. When many systems do their environmental plans or climate action plans, the utility is obviously a significant contributor to that. So that alignment with the goals of communities and regions is really a feature of public power, and it's something that I think creates an opportunity for people that would want to do business with public power. You can also look at understanding where are they, where do they reside, what are the objectives of the communities they serve, and how are these things reflected in their operations. Amongst the members of the large public power council, we have people from Seattle to South Carolina, and their local governance, their objectives, their environmental aspirations, many things are very different. And so they're very responsive to the, again, local or regional objectives of the municipalities they serve. Next slide. So one of the things that is remarkable is there's over 2,000 public power systems, and they provide electricity to 49 million people in 49 states. The only state that doesn't have public power, I believe, is Hawaii. And there's also 5 U.S. territories, including Puerto Rico, the U.S. Virgin Islands, and others. So in terms of just sheer numbers of electricity customers served in the U.S., about 1 in 7. So that just tells you these are, in many cases, pretty small cities. There's also large cities, but in a lot of the areas that are served by public power, there's a great pride in having a public power system in your communities, especially small communities. I witnessed this in Washington State with the public utility districts there, or if you go to states like Nebraska, which is the only state in the United States that's 100% public power, and all the small rural communities in Nebraska are very proud of the fact that they're public power systems. Next slide. So one of the things that besides environmental stewardship and affordability and reliability, more and more people are focused on the role of the public power system as an economic engine for their communities. Collectively, there's about 93,000 people that are employed. These are actually very high-paying, stable jobs, which is good for the local economies and regional economies they serve. And there's about $58 billion in revenue annually. So So when you look at this factor of alignment to communities, it creates a synergy when a community has certain economic development objectives, and the utility that has such a key stake in that by having affordable or clean energy to support those objectives, it really can move the needle in terms of the economic activity. And I will say that the investments that public power systems make in their communities have a significant economic multiplier when you consider the trickle-down effect or the expanded effect of a dollar that's invested in the community in the form of lower rates or in the form of employment, and how that multiplies to really benefit the community. Next slide. So here's the kind of the distribution, if you will, of public power systems. Of the 2,000, 1,350 serve under 4,000 people. If you think about that for a minute, that's a 4,000 people. There's a lot of communities in rural America that are served by public power that are very, very small. And as members of the American Public Power Association, our national association, it's really wonderful to get to meet your colleagues and see the dedication they have from these small communities. If you go to the 30 public power systems that serve over 100,000, those are the members that I support. And again, out of 2,000, there's probably just about these 30 systems that serve numbers like that and that are in large metropolitan areas. Next slide. And this just again speaks to the fact that the generation, transmission, and distribution of the percentages of public power. And I would say if you stratify that in the same way you stratify the numbers of members, you would find that a significant portion of that is owned by either large integrated utilities and or large joint action that owns multiple generation that actually benefits additional public power systems. So there's a lot of collective activity that goes on with public power to help give the smaller systems the benefit of scale. And that's something that we really do to help each other. So thank you and look forward to the conversation going forward.
Thank you very much, John. Next slide.
So thanks, John. You did a really great job. This reiterates a lot of what John has just covered, starting with the second bullet on this slide. And when you talk about the idea that economic development is a priority for public power systems, obviously they have a reason to care. It's the health of their community. It's the quality of life in their community. So when you look at doing business with a public power system, you get a one-stop shop. You have the opportunity to come in and sit down and talk to the folks that are also going to be talking to you about the local tax structure, incentive packages. Public power systems have very strong relationships with their state, their county, and their regional economic development officials as well, too. Typically, majority of public power systems of any size, and even some of the smaller ones, have someone on their staff who's dedicated to economic development. So it is a one-stop shop, and you're also talking to the folks that control, in many cases, the other utilities that are necessary. It's not just an electric operation. They also deal with, in some cases, gas, broadband, et cetera. So it's a very efficient way to sit down and have a conversation. Also, sometimes I think we get a bad rap in public power for not being as innovative, particularly the smaller systems, and that's just really not the case. Certainly the larger systems across the country, at SMUD, for instance, where John was CEO, absolutely at the forefront on lots of different initiatives. But we have smaller systems in my membership, and I represent, as you'll hear in a bit, a number of smaller systems, and they've done some very innovative things. The first public power system with solar and a battery was in Minster, Ohio. So these types of things can happen in smaller systems depending on what makes sense for them. Again, it's a direct link between customers and their utility. That's a great thing about a public power system is it is a community spirit. You have the community leaders are involved in what happens, and you know, you have relationships with the chamber and other entities in a community. So those are some of the advantages of doing business with public power. We obviously have talked about the strong level of reliability, the competitive rates, the focus on sustainability. Those are all important pieces as well, too. We included a few best practices for engaging with public power as well, too. It's important when talking to public power systems to talk about the overall benefit to the community, not just be focused on the electric utility aspect of whatever sort of a partnership or arrangement may be being discussed. Always good in any case dealing with any type of utility to be clear about the goals and the desired outcomes. John, I don't know if you want to add anything to that slide or not. Okay. I would say that we are cutting edge but not bleeding edge when it comes to innovation. We make wise decisions. So if we could go to the next slide, please. We're going to each take an opportunity when we go through our individual one-on-one slides here to talk a bit about some of the things that we've all done. But you see a list here of some of the things that the public power systems have done that are at the forefront when it comes to advanced energy deployment and procurement. We have proven experience with electric vehicles, grid modernization, renewables integration, behind-the-meter generation, energy efficiency. Public power systems are right there with our brethren in the other utility sectors. And in many cases, ahead of the game when it comes to what can work, because we do have a different perspective on things, because we're looking at EV charging from a community standpoint. We're looking at microgrids from a community standpoint. So a bit of a different vantage point than we may sometimes people may think we have. I think we can go on, Lisa, to having the individual folks now go through their slides.
Okay, that sounds great. I think AMP is first up, so why don't you take the next slide?
Okay. Sure. So we are, AMP is short for American Municipal Power. We've been around since the 1970s. We're a wholesale power supplier and we service provider for 135 municipal electric systems in 9 states, and you can see the list of states there. We're based in Columbus, Ohio, started in Ohio, have largely expanded our geographic reach as a result of what's happening in our part of the country with the regional transmission organizations and the desire by the public power systems in our part of the country to make sure they have appropriate economies of scale. The majority of AMP members are villages, so they're in that category that John talked about, where typically 5,000 or less would be a village size in our part of the country. And so the majority of our members are villages. We do have some larger members, Cleveland Public Power, City of Columbus, Danville, Virginia, but the majority of our folks are small to small cities to villages. We represent about 650,000 customers across our membership footprint. We have total assets of more than $6.7 billion and a very diverse resource portfolio. If you look at what we've done as an organization, we just got done with the largest development of new run-of-the-river hydro in the United States at existing locks and dams, core locks and dams on the Ohio River. Between our new projects and existing projects, we have just shy of just about 400 megawatts of hydro in our portfolio in a part of the country where you don't always hear folks say something like that. We do have a balanced portfolio. We have some coal resources, some natural gas resources. We also have the largest solar, utility solar in the state of Ohio at 20 megawatts, and we have solar arrays going into a number of other states as well. We have financed our projects using largely tax exempt financing, but also Build America bonds and some other tax opportunities that we've been able to put together. All of our projects are rated by the rating agencies as an A category. We have a 21-member board of trustees. They're made up of our member system officials, typically city managers and utility directors. And we have a staff of about 175, and that includes our employees working at our generating assets. So from our standpoint, the priorities and challenges that we see going forward have to do with making sure our members are successful. So again, we have 135 members across 9 states, and those are very different states when it comes to what the underlying state policies are, what the motivations are, what the interest level is by customers of advanced energy in those states. We want to make sure our members are ready and prepared We've worked very hard through an effort we call the Focus Forward Initiative. We have an advisory council of our member community officials and some of the consultants that do work with our members to help our members be prepared when someone wants to come into their community and deploy advanced energy resources. And so we've worked very hard on that front. We want to make sure, again, our members are successful, and we provide as many of the resources as we can, because in the case of our members that are smaller, they may not have the staff on their own staff to do that. We have been recognized for our sustainability efforts. We were a finalist for the Platts Global Energy Awards for our energy efficiency program a few years ago. We just won the Ohio EPA's Platinum Award, which is the top award they give out for our sustainability efforts. We have a portfolio of power supply for our members that is in excess of 20% renewable, and that is all having happened with no mandates. So again, because we're not subject to the State Utility Commission jurisdiction, the decisions about what types of resources to invest in are made by our members. And they've made the decision that they want to have a balanced portfolio, and they want to make sure they have renewables in that portfolio. And then other priority and challenge for us is working in the organized markets, working with PJM and MISO. For the folks on the call that have been active in those arenas, you know that it's an ever-changing target with respect to what the rules look like for what you can build and what you can do and how you can operate that generation and how it's priced and all those sorts of things. So we are actively engaged at PJM. We have full-time staff in Pennsylvania tracking PJM, as well as folks back in our office. And then again, as I mentioned, we have experience with advanced energy deployments at the utility scale, but we've also worked with our members when they've wanted to do things behind the meter as well. So, you know, AMP is a progressive organization, and we are excited about what's happening in the industry. Turn it back over to you, Lisa.
Terrific. I think next up is Tracy, correct?
With yes, Shalane? This is Tracy. Yeah, Tracy with Shalane PUD. So you'll see a number of different things on this slide, but what I want to focus in on is we are basically 100% clean hydro generation on the Columbia River. We have about 2,000 megawatts of generation, and we have 500 megawatts of domestic load on our distribution system. So we're set up a little differently in that we're generally an exporter of energy. Our residential rates are about 3.2 cents a kilowatt hour, which has been one of the draws for cryptocurrency and Bitcoin in central Washington. So we've seen some changes lately, which is requiring us to engage setting rates in different ways to make sure we're protecting our investments. We're a large organization relative to the size of our community. We have about 50,000 meters, 50,000 customers, but we obviously have a lot more power than we sell up and down the West Coast. We have water, wastewater system, high-speed fiber infrastructure, 1,000 megabit per second. We own and operate 14 parks on the Columbia River and up at Lake Chelan. And we have a great deal of environmental obligations and investments that our community really treasures and values. And that's one of the things that John was touching on. Some of the things that we're looking forward within the state and the region is really continuing to invest in defining a least cost, reliable approach to carbon emissions reductions. What we've done, though, is to help us analyze that, we and some other members of a trade organization, Public Generating Pool, have developed a regional policy scenario analysis tool. It's basically a model that we can assess the implications of different policies as it relates to cost, emissions, and reliability. So as people come up with a different carbon approach, putting a price on carbon or an RPS or a carbon tax or any different scenarios, we can run the model and get a sense for what the cost would be, what the implications of reliability are, as well as what does it do ultimately to emissions. We're also investing in a more detailed reliability analysis model that looks at a larger footprint, Washington, Oregon, Idaho, part of Idaho, Western Montana, so we can get a sense for If we do see some of these policies are getting some momentum, we can speak from a position of having information relative to what does it mean for system reliability. The model results in the study, I think, have been very helpful for us understanding where to focus in the future. One of those things is really what's the next generation of energy efficiency investments? And as the value of energy efficiency in the Pacific Northwest and the West Coast becomes more apparent, how do we invest more in those types of things that we can actually benefit from the reductions rather than additional generation? Last I'd like to leave you with is much of the hydro facilities we have here on the Columbia River. One of our facilities is the oldest powerhouse in the Columbia River that was started in the 1930s, and it's also at the same facility, the newest powerhouse built on the Columbia River in the 70s. But our aging infrastructure has to be reinvested, and we've spent and are continuing to spend hundreds of millions of dollars bringing our facilities up to date. And we see that's critical to achieve the low-cost, reliable carbon reduction. Hydro plays a very important role, specifically in the Pacific Northwest. Ability to integrate additional renewable resources that we think are needed to meet the state's objectives of carbon reduction. And these resources that we have are really the most effective way to do that instead of building new resources is largely to reinvest in the existing resources. So Chelan PD is a little different in that we have far more generation than we need. We are, as John mentioned, one of the organizations that has a 5-member elected governing board who do represent their constituents' interests and largely influence what it is we focus on relative to value to our community, keeping rates low, and our environmental stewardship. And so continuing to pay down our debt, investing in our community where we can, and continuing to work within the region, focusing in on carbon. So with that, I'll turn it back over.
Thanks very much. Appreciate it. Next slide. I don't think we have anybody on from CPS Energy. Is that correct? So just quickly, that they basically, as many of you know, CPS is probably one of the largest municipal utilities. They serve the city of San Antonio, and I'm not going to go through this in detail, but we will send around this deck so you can all have the details about CPS Energy. They're doing a lot of different creative things. They have $11 billion in assets, and they're governed by a local board of trustees. We'll go on to the next slide. And so we have LADWP. I think Jesse's on the line, Vismonte, who's going to present. Jesse, you there?
Yep, I'm here.
Great. Over to you.
Thanks, Lisa. So jumping right into it, LADWP's power system supplies more than 26 million megawatt hours of electricity annually for the city's 1.5 million residential and business customers. We also have 5,000 customers in the Owens Valley and in the eastern part of California, where we have 8 small hydroelectric plants. This customer base makes us the largest municipal utility in the United States. To give you a sense of our assets, we have over 9,890 megawatts of net maximum plant capacity from a diverse mix of energy resources, and LADWP expects to meet about 34% of its load with renewable energy in 2018. This makes us well positioned to meet the state mandated level of 33% renewable by 2020. The power system is responsible for 5 thermal plants, 14 small hydroelectric plants, one large hydroelectric plant that also acts as pump storage, one wind facility, and 2 solar facilities. LADWP owns and operates in excess of 25% of the transmission in California, and a lot of that is due to the 2 DC lines that we own and operate. LADWP I should mention, is governed by a 5-member Board of Water and Power Commissioners who are appointed by the mayor of LA and then confirmed by the LA City Council. Every year, the power system transfers 8% of its gross operating revenue to the city's general fund each year, and the power system budget is $4 billion for the current fiscal year. One note is LADWP is a member of the Southern California Public Power Authority, also known as SCAPA. And SCAPA is a joint powers agency comprised of 11 municipal utilities, including us, and one irrigation district. And SCAPA was created really for the purpose of providing joint financing, construction, and operation of transmission and generation projects. And we enter in a number of power purchasing agreements with our SCAPA partners where we are able to procure a lot of our renewable energy. Some of our notable upcoming challenges listed here include the elimination of once-through ocean cooling as mandated by the state, the City Council's 100% clean energy motion, the divestment of coal resources by 2025. We have targets of 580,000 electric vehicles by 2030 and 25,000 electric vehicle chargers by 2025. As well as a target of 15% additional energy savings from 2017 to 2027. So that's a little bit of background of LADWP, and with that, I'll turn it over back to Lisa.
Okay, thank you so much. I appreciate it. I think from SMUD, I'm not sure if Lupe is on. Is there anybody else from SMUD on the call? Okay, just quickly, the slide here kind of just highlights some of the key things from SMUD, and again, we'll be sending the slides around, but SMUD is the sixth largest community-owned electric utility, and they are governed by a 7-member electric board of directors. So they're roughly at about $1.6 billion in revenue, and 50% of their power currently comes from non-carbon emitting resources. I'm going to move on to the next slide, and I think Josh is presenting from Salt River Project. Josh, you're up.
Yes, thanks, Lisa. This is Josh Robertson with Salt River Project. I wanted to give you kind of a quick rundown of who we are. We are actually two distinct entities. The first is the Water Users Association. This was established right around the turn of the 20th century. It's one of the first reclamation projects in the West. We still continue to deliver about 800,000 acre feet of water to the Phoenix metropolitan area, the Valley. As an outgrowth of that, we started to sell electricity utilizing the hydroelectric facilities on our river systems. And that was when the Improvement and Power District was established in 1937. That is a political subdivision of the state of Arizona. With that, we serve right about 1 million electric customers, again, in the Phoenix metropolitan area. We're governed by a publicly elected board that is elected. There's a 10-member board that has certain sections, and then there's 4 at-large members that are elected. We're about 34% carbon-free right now. We will be expanding that portfolio as we move forward, as are most people. We have a significant suite of energy efficiency options for our customers. As you can see here, we have about 570,000 megawatt hours saved last year alone. It's a really long track record at SRP of looking at energy efficiency and offering those programs to our customers. We do treat energy efficiency as a resource option in our planning, so we look at it as a viable resource when we go through each yearly planning cycle, and then also as we go through our integrated resource planning process that we do over the course of several years as well. As far as some recent developments of advanced energy deployment, SRP, as with others, are very interested in the storage technology space. We really want to get our feet wet in this environment and understand what the implications are to the system, what the benefits are, that really hold out a lot of hope for the further development and the further cost declines in battery storage. We currently have 2 standalone projects. One's located at a substation. The other is located at a one of our older simple cycle gas units, power plant. Those are 25 megawatts and 10 megawatts respectively. We also have an integrated solar and battery project that just recently came online as well. That's a 20 megawatt solar facility paired with a 10 megawatt battery project on site. So those are very interesting. We have a pretty, let's call it rough environment here in the summer. You know, temperatures regularly above 110 degrees. So we are quite interested in how these batteries hold up in that environment. We're hopeful that they will continue to operate and not see significant degradation, but it's something that we're going to be interested in looking at, seeing how these perform. We also have a residential battery storage program that just came out in last May, where we offer customers up to $1,800 or $150 per DC kilowatt hour, up to $1,800. That's available for 4,500 customers for the next 3 years, so until May of 2021. To date, this program started in May of this year. We have 330 reservations where those are real firm reservations where they've already been installed. Those customers have spent money for a contractor to either be under contract or actually install those facilities, the battery storage projects at the home. And then we have an additional 170, what we're calling soft reservations, that are locked in for a 90-day period, but they may have not taken that expense with the contractor yet to solidify it and make it firm. Additionally, we have a 650 megawatt all source RFP that just recently went out. Here we're looking at anything that is capable of serving over our peak. Batteries, demand response, gas, anything really, again, looking at energy efficiency as a resource as well as those other technologies and what can the market bring to bear here. So we're focused about 100 megawatts in 2022, and that ramps up to 650 megawatts by 2025. Those proposals are due at the beginning of next year, mid-January, and we should have a selection in April of 2019. We're excited to see what that RFP brings, given the changing dynamic and technologies in the industry at the moment. We're also very active in the EV space. We've got over 4,500 current EVs in our system. We have an EV community where we collaborate and actively engage with EV owners with about 1,400 customers that are involved in that. We have a time of use rate specifically designed for electric vehicles with currently 1,100 customers on that. We most recently worked with EPRI, the Electric Power Research Institute, and Fleet Karma to install data loggers in over 100 EVs in our system with, again, that collaborative approach to our customers and the EV owners in our territory. We were able to install those, and we found a lot of really interesting data that came out of that. We found our TOU plans were being effective and giving the proper price signals for when those EVs were charged and they weren't charged. We also have the largest workplace charging system in the state of Arizona with over 90 chargers at our workplace. And then it seems as if we're continuing to expand that regularly. That's kind of a quick rundown of SRP's current efforts and then kind of a little bit of background of who we are, and appreciate the opportunity to give the presentation.
Thanks, Josh. So next up, I think can you go one ahead, Eric, on the next slide? All right, Jolene, is there anything else you want to add? Otherwise, I might just start asking a few questions.
No, I'm good, thank you.
Okay. You know, maybe I'll start off, Josh, since you were talking about storage and your work on EVs. Rate design has been coming up quite a bit in terms of how to better integrate some of these technologies. Can you comment a little bit on, and any public power entity, by the way, should feel free to jump in as well, but what are you doing in terms of rate design that might be of interest to our members to know how you're addressing the issue of integrating storage or electric vehicles?
So we actually have, you know, to be honest, we're still evaluating a lot of that, and that's a lot of what that data set was coming in to look at. But we do believe, and SRP has believed for a very long time, that we need to provide proper price signals to our customers to incent that behavior that everyone can benefit from, right? If they reduce their overall energy consumption at peak, we see the benefit, the customers see the benefit, and reduce bills. So we've had a lot of we've had time of use programs for over 20 years. We've had significant deployment of advanced metering infrastructure for a very long period of time as well. So we have a lot of data that we're working with and trying to look at what works good for our customers, what works good for our customers on our system, and how do we go about setting those price signals such that it works out for everyone. I think the results that we've seen from the work we've done with EPRI is that, you know, customers, again, are responsive to those price signals for charging their EVs, whether they're charging them at home or whether they're charging them at the workplace. I think we can get around. We have a very peaky hour in Arizona, where we have almost a needle peak, where, you know, there's only a few hours of the year where we're at an exceptionally high load. And so if we can get around that, that does save us a lot of money. So that's kind of what we're focused on at the moment.
Okay.
Hey, Lisa, this is John DeStacio. Can I
please feel free to jump in. Yep, and I've got a lot of questions that are coming in from the listeners.
I'll be free. I'll just say that pricing and changing pricing is one of the most significant activities that people are undertaking, because there's a recognition that now people use less energy, they self-generate. Utilities used to have a bundled volumetric price because they also had the right, if you will, to serve every electron, and that's changed. So I think in the new world, the focus now has really gone to time differentiated rates. And while those rates have been around for many years, they've been around as voluntary rates. And what I'm seeing now is many systems, I know SMUD is moving to a time of day rate as their standard rate. And I think this is going to be a trend you'll see. And that'll really provide, again, consumers options to make good informed economic decisions about, should I invest in an EV, should I invest in PV, how much should I take from my grid provider? And I think it really starts to acknowledge and open up a more of a marketplace that doesn't mute what the underlying costs and benefits of different resources are.
Great. Thanks, John. So another question that came in from one of the listeners, and I don't know which one of you wants to take this, but our public power utilities looking at securitization or green bonds to address stranded generation assets and the associated economic displacement or transition? Do any of you want to take that on particularly?
I'm not familiar with any systems that are looking at that. I do know that people pay close attention to stranded assets, and I do know that the days of people investing in 40-year large central station power plants are really, unless there's a significant securitization amongst the members that you're serving, it's pretty difficult to think. I think we're moving more to a hybrid, and that transition will take time. But I'm not familiar with people looking at dealing with the stranded investment through green bonds.
I would agree with that, Lisa. That's not okay. Something that we've heard discussed here. Obviously, we have invested in some long-term assets, but those are backed by our members, and the way they've structured their portfolios are not overly leveraged in any one type of resource.
Okay. Another question came in. I often hear municipal utilities say we don't have the money as the large, we don't have the same kind of money that the large IOUs have. What would you recommend to vendors that have been focused on IOUs but are now looking to offer their solutions and services to the municipal market?
Well, I'll take this from a slightly different perspective than some of the other folks on the call, and that would be there are entities like AMP operating across the country called Joint Action Agencies. Might make some sense to go in and sit down and talk to the Joint Action Organization, who represents a series of the smaller systems, and talk to us about the types of things that we're doing to try to help our members, because there may be some opportunities there.
Okay. Does anybody else want to chime in? Okay, another question is, do any of the public power entities have had success with on-bill financing for energy efficiency or electrification upgrades? Just need LADWP. Go ahead, John.
I can speak to that. We actually had a significant on-bill financing portfolio at SMUD for energy efficiency and actually some renewables. Now they're looking at providing some on-bill financing also for vehicle chargers and so forth. They've actually established what they call a storefront, and they're selling different energy efficiency products and so forth. So I know SMUD's certainly not the only one, but I do know that there has been, with the low cost of capital for municipal entities, providing financing for consumers, especially for some of the energy efficiency things, is really fairly common.
Okay. And then switching gears a little bit, you know, I know the IOUs have done a lot of work, or, you know, there's been a lot of talk around the U.S. around business model reform, utility business model reform, specifically moving more toward performance-based incentives or equalizing operating expenses versus CapEx. Municipal or public entities are not regulated the same way, but are you moving, you know, and implementing programs that are moving more toward performance incentives or dealing with operating expenses and CapEx? I don't know if one of you want to take that, Josh or Jesse.
Yeah, this is Josh. I think I can speak a little bit towards that. You know, you referenced it a bit in the intro of that, you know, we are structured much different than investor-owned utilities, right? The investor-owned utilities they have a rate base that gets established, and they earn a rate of return on that rate base. So if the volumetric levels that are based on the rate base and getting that rate base plus the return, if they don't get the energy sales associated with that, then they don't get that return, right? Public power is a little bit different in that, you know, we don't have that return component. There's a small return. We have to, you know, pay our interest on debt, et cetera, but we don't have that same incentive there. So to the extent, you know, at least for SRP, to the extent we reduce our overall costs, that flows directly towards our consumers. It doesn't necessarily get our investors cut off. So I think that's a pretty big difference between the IOU work that's being done on kind of this, you know, really decoupling of the energy and having performance-based rates to the more of the public power entities.
Great. There's a question specifically for Shalane. What do you mean by adjusting rates to ensure that investments are protected? So Tracy, do you want to take that?
Yeah, sure. So what we're seeing is with, for example, Bitcoin operators coming in and cryptocurrency, is these facilities that they bring in to perform these tasks are highly mobile. And they're basically in shipping containers. And so the huge demand that they need, if our system exists is in place and can serve them, that's one thing. If, however, they require additional infrastructure, we want to make sure that we don't install that infrastructure on our distribution system for them to potentially leave before that investment is paid off. So we're in the process of developing new residential, non-residential rates, because some of these cryptocurrency miners are in residential places, and so upfront charges and et cetera. So it's really creating a new rate structure for this emerging type of demand that covers both the infrastructure and the actual energy costs.
Great. Terrific. Thank you. Mm-hmm. There was also a question here, and I can't remember which of the utilities mentioned it, but somebody asked, what is once through ocean cooling? I don't know if that was I think it was LADWP who mentioned that in their slide. Jesse, do you recall that? Was that you?
Yeah, this is Jesse with LADWP. So I mentioned that as one of our challenges. So first off, once through ocean cooling is the use of ocean water to cool steam in a thermodynamic cycle and it's critical for our steam power plants. But we're mandated by the state of California to get rid of all once through ocean cooling by 2029. So the challenge is not using ocean water to cool our thermal systems and instead use similar systems, but that use air typically, which are called air cooled condensers. So switching over to those from our perspective is a great challenge. And again, we're mandated by the state to do so by 2029.
Thank you. So there's another question here. If a customer with a large load greater than 5 megawatts is seeking creation of a new rate, what factors do you view as important to consider for success? Jolene, do you want to try to take that one? Or
John or I, either one can. I would say it is, well, first of all, you're going to have to, in the case of some of my members, find a system that can accommodate a 5-megawatt load, which I have many who can, but that's a big load on some of my very tiny villages. My larger villages and cities, that would be fine. So you would be wanting to look at whether or not the system is large enough in the case of the smaller systems that are out there. It's the typical negotiation that you would have. You're going to want to come in and talk about your expectations, and the community is going to need to tell you what sort of infrastructure they might have to build to serve you. Does that require a substation? What sort of operational changes might be required? How should that be dealt with? If you're outside the city limits, which we have some communities where that load can be outside the city limits, which in our case means that there's not a certified territory, what sort of agreement contract would you enter into to guarantee that you're going to stay there for a certain period of time? So, John, I'm sure can add to this, that is the top of mind in my members' case, what we would be looking at. The kind of load you're bringing in, the type of employment, all of that.
Yeah, that's right. I think the thing is, a couple things that would always be looked at is, besides the infrastructure, is the power factor. Is it a real spiky load, or is it a load that's consistent? So is it a complementary load in the system relative to the infrastructure that's there? Many municipalities also look at, is this a large load, or is it a large employer? Does it bring jobs and economic activity to the community? So even if it's not jobs, I think trying to speak to the economic benefits of that business residing in a community is also a helpful aspect when you sit down to talk to the utility.
Great. There's another question. I'm not quite sure I understand the question, but it just says, where would you put community choice aggregation, CCAs?
Lisa, I saw that one, and I'm going to pitch this to the Californians to answer, but I'm guessing they're saying, where would you put them in the context of where do they fit in the utilities group? We were talking about the different types of utilities. That's my guess as to what that question might be getting at.
Yeah, maybe. Do you want to try to answer that, Jolene, or do you want to...
I'm going to pitch that to the Californians who have the CCAs in their state.
All right, Jesse, it's over to you.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Or Smud, or go ahead.
Well, this is John. I would just say the CCA, the Community Choice Aggregation, it really was established as a means for communities to establish really their own power supply portfolio. Other things have come along with it. They pay an exit fee to the investor-owned utilities that they're leaving. So they're truly not a public power system. They're somewhere in between. And that's still a work in progress, even though they're set up and they're moving and they're active. There's a lot going on in the California legislature right now to relook at some of the CPUC to relook at some of the exit fees. And so the economics those could change over time. But in terms of where they fit in, they don't really fit cleanly in any category, I would say. Because
okay.
the investor-owned utility still provides the poles and wires and the service. They basically take a power supply and they pay an exit fee to the power supply that was already obtained on their behalf. So again, I think that it's a hybrid. You have some private and some public activity in there.
Okay. And I know we're running against a little bit toward the end of the call here, but I do have a couple quick questions. Eric, do you mind if I ask two more questions? Are you on?
Go ahead, Lisa.
All right. Because I think this is an important one. City council members are less familiar with utility issues than utility commissioners, and how do municipalities go about educating city council members about energy?
Lisa, I'm sure John may have some comment on this too. I would say that I have some city council members that are as up to speed as some of the state utility commissioners that I've dealt with on energy issues. But beyond that, we do a lot of work with going out and sitting down in our member communities and having sessions with our officials, talking about what's happening in the industry. We have publications, we have webinars, we have conferences. We provide our members a lot of information that they can then provide to their governing board. So that's something that we are aware is an important thing. And they have to look at this as part of their budget, and they have to understand it. And so I think they may be a little more knowledgeable in many cases than they're given credit for.
And you mentioned a conference. There was another question in here about, is there a national conference that brings together public power entities on a national level? I'd have the answer, but I'll let one of you guys answer that.
The American Public Power Association, which John and I are both active in fact, I'm vice chair of the board right now, we have an annual conference in June each year that brings together public power entities, but there's also different conferences that bring together the engineering and operations group, policy folks, communicators, business and finance folks. So there's about five or six big conferences nationally that provide opportunities for different folks within public power communities to go and share and network.
Great. Thank you so much. And finally, the last question, how can our members approach you for partnerships or working more together on some of these, you know, next generation items like EVs and, you know, storage and integration on some of these more complex issues? I think, you know, a lot of times we've heard IOUs say, just come and talk to us. But, you know, do you still IOUs typically go out with formal RFPs. I don't know if there are other restrictions that are more tight in terms of having some of our members come directly to you. I was wondering if one of you can comment on how best our members can approach you and trying to work on partnerships to solve and do pilots around some of these issues.
This is Josh Robertson from SRP. So speaking specifically for us, you know, we have that 650 megawatt all source RFP that's currently out there. So I'd encourage anyone that's interested to take a look at that. With regard to those specific things we're looking for in that RFP, we would probably need to drive most of those conversations through that formal RFP process as that's going on. But I would also just put out there that to the extent anyone has something they'd like to talk about, you know, they can have my contact information and they'll reach out.
Okay. Anybody else want to comment from the
public? I would agree that just call us and talk to us. And in the case of my members, you can give AMP a call and then we can work with our members if you want to make one call instead of calling on a variety of folks. But we're always interested in the ideas that people have. And sometimes our members bring us ideas, and sometimes vendors come and talk to us and different companies. We're really very open to that.
Great. Well, thank you all very much. This has been extremely helpful. I know we've gone a little past our time, but I want to thank Jolene, Tracy, Jesse, John, and Josh for participating, and all the other public power entities who helped put together the slides for our members. We've had a great discussion, and thank you all for your time today. This has been very helpful. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.